I'm Sushil Ajgaonkar, and I belong to the Center of Excellence within L&T Infotech. And one of the areas within the Center of Excellence is service-oriented architectures. So we look at how we have been working on it for about 3-4 years now, and we looked at starting with, you know, what the standards are, what the tools are, moving on to helping customers creating services. So what I'm going to share today actually is three ways. We look at SOA adoption, and since it's a big topic, we'll try to classify the SOA adoption being done at customers so that it simplifies or it helps us to understand the motivation for SOA in a particular case. And that we will, I will use that theory sort of in the case studies which I'll be talking about later. So the second item is the case studies. Finally, I'll conclude the presentation with some of the challenges which we have seen while implementing SOA at our customer's place. So I'm sure that will help you, at least that can be a consideration for you when you start your journey. Right. Now, when we look at SOA adoption, now you have, for the past 3-4 days, you have looked at how to create a service. You know, you have looked at what are the standards, you have worked with some of the tools to build services, maybe you have built some applications to consume the service. Okay. But that, I would say, is creating services at an application level. Now, when we talk of the industry and the you know, customers at large who are actually going to implement SOA, it is the enterprise perspective we have to keep in mind. Okay. And one of the challenges or the problems there is the context becomes very different. When you talk of application, you still have, you know, lot of things in your control, so to speak. You are the application owner, you can talk to, he can give you, you know, how the application was built, he will have some documentation and things like that. But when it goes to the enterprise context, there the landscape entirely changed. So one is the set of applications remain as a variable, if I have to say what are the variables which you have to consider when you go on to the enterprise scope, is one is the application in themselves, but then there are a lot of applications spread over a lot of the geography, and then, you know, you have then many other aspects to cover or talk about. So what we thought is, when we talk to customers and when we talk to peers and colleagues in our group itself, how do we, you know, when we have to communicate about SOA, somebody is adopting SOA, what does it really mean? So we have to break it down. So this model or a picture which you see is a step towards that, to be able to classify exactly what is being done or is being attempted in a particular case. So we start with business services, reusable business services. This is the first step which most people would do, you know, where you would start service enabling your applications, as we call it. You take up the application, and here the application could be a legacy application or an application which has already been in use. It has been in use and continues to be in use. You are adding a service interface to that, and then you make it more business-like, of course. So for an example, suppose it's a financial domain, or let us take which most of you might be familiar with, the payroll application kind of scenario. So there, what are the set of services? So you would want to calculate you know, people's income tax, you would want to calculate the total takeaway, you may want a service to you know, give out salary slip, things like that. So all of these are grouped, and you would have a business service you know, card out of this payroll application. The motivation for that is primarily what the you know, the benefit what the companies get out of this is that this service can now become a reusable entity which can be consumed in multiple applications. Later on, I have a small example which I will try to illustrate this aspect of reusable business services. But the point is, the motivation more is to be able to use the data and the functionality which is already available and to build, make it available for more people to consume, more applications to consume. Okay, so that's the reduce operating cost value proposition for the business services. You move on to the right, the service-oriented integration. Once you build services, now what do you do next? So we build applications where we can consume them. But that's a simple kind of point-to-point calling of a service. You have scenarios where you may want to use the same service by multiple applications. That's one. Second scenario is the application which you are trying to build, which will consume services, could be calling multiple services out of, and these services could be coming out of different applications. So you have heard, they have heard about ESBs, Enterprise Service Bus. Okay. So there's a notion of or a requirement where you may want to call multiple services from multiple applications and using multiple protocols. Till date, you must have heard about SOAP over HTTP as the mechanism or as the method to invoke a service. But then once you have a service, people say, why should we get constrained by being able to be called over by SOAP over HTTP alone? Can I call it in a different method? Can I call it in a with a different transport? So what is an example? You could have in companies, they have these queuing systems. So can I call this service using my queuing system? So you have SOAP over JMS kind of scenario. Or can I make a you know, simple XML call still and be able to get the service? So now things are, you know, from the puristic approach where you have SOAP over HTTP, you may also want the same service to be called by multiple protocols. So ESB, Enterprise Service Bus, is a concept, and nowadays there are implementations also available which allow you to achieve this. And service-oriented integration is about integration, you know, doing or creating an integration using a ESB. Now what's new here is, previously also we had application integration, EAI, if many of you must have heard, enterprise application integration. So that was prevalent. So what is different here? Here, the whole idea is you do your integrations with standards. So you would use web services standard, use the JMS standard, you would use the HTTP standard. Unlike in EAI tools or products, where they have their own proprietary protocols to achieve the integration. So that's the difference. And in terms of benefit for the organizations, again we say it helps to reduce the operating cost. The reason is because of standardization, there is a competition, and then the EAI tools, the way the price points or the levels at which they were priced, we find that the ESBs are much more, you know, cost effective, and you could achieve more or less many of the features which were provided by the ESBs, by the EAI tools. So in that sense, now we see a trend, you know, whereby new integrations which are being built are built using the service integration model or the service integration route. Okay. The overall, you know, as they call it, the total cost of ownership for the enterprise comes down because the product itself is, you know, less costlier, and then the maintenance revenues and all that which they have to pay, that gets reduced in comparison with the EAI tools, right? Any questions till now?
Business processes and rules keeps on changing. For example, with every budget, they change in income tax rules, they change in excise sector rules.
Right.
So, but if we have some sort of automation on these, how can we ensure reusability of services? Where consistency is also to be ensured?
Right. So, the question is, the rules keep changing, and then how can the old service serve the purpose? Now, having recognized that the rules change, so what people say is the service is one aspect which will get impacted by this. And how do you reduce the impact is within the application itself. What you do is you try to use abstract these rules in a different way, so as to see that the service is less impacted. And one of the solutions is, as you see in the fourth box, foundation for BPM. Now, business process management is an area which actually tries to tackle that much more efficiently and in a much more better manner, where they have kept provisions for this change aspect which will come into the picture. Okay. So my answer would be that instead of looking at the service, we may have to look at the application which is combining the service to try to get some abstraction for the changes. Right. Any other question? Okay. So we move on to the composite applications. What are composite applications? Once we have service, again I go back to the simple principle where you have a service and then you make a simple application which will consume the service. But then you can extend this same idea where you now kind of, instead of one service, you build the application by having a large collection of services. And where are these services coming from? They need not come from one application now. They can come from multiple applications within your company. They can be services which are hosted by third-party people, available outside your enterprise. You can combine, mix them together, and then build nice set of applications. So today, what is happening is, against this, what used to happen earlier, so that then you get the better picture of the difference or what this brings to the table, is earlier you would be restricted to one application and then you would use that application's user interface to communicate with the application. Okay. So if I had, let me give an example of say leave and attendance. Okay. Typical ways, we use one application to post our leaves. Then, or we send an email to our manager and say we want a leave and he approves it. But then when he has to kind of worry about what impact is going to happen if you are going to leave, okay, then he would go into the project management, software and try to see, okay, where are you allocated? So he has to open yet another application, okay? And then, multiple such things come into the picture and then you switch between applications and of course you are doing your job and finally you give your approval. Imagine a scenario if you are able to, on the same user interface, able to view, first get the request of the employee, get the project information also, and then you have some way to communicate to your employee back saying approved or disapproved. All that together, won't it be a convenience? You are now not moving around into multiple applications. This all get merged into one application. Okay, so that is the concept or the value which the composite applications bring. And this is a very small example which I give. People are now talking of bigger examples, and in the companies where you have to collaborate with multiple people. I receive an application, I need somebody else's input, I have to forward it somewhere, then he kind of responds, and then I get it back. Then I want to work with yet some other application based on that input. And finally, I want to post it into a transactional system where I actually, the application would persist the data. Now, all such things can be very neatly done by what is generally termed as composite applications. Okay, so the word comes from the English meaning of composite, the compose part, where you are now able to compose services, number one, make a bigger service. You can compose at the application level, so the consumption of the service. Also, you can have composition in the picture, wherein you will compose multiple services and then make an application. Right? This is a slightly newer concept. People have been also doing, when you talk of integrations also, this has been in the background. But with composite applications, it has come to the surface, so to speak. Now it is becoming more apparent. We talk about it little more. But then the idea is, finally, yes, it's an integration, but then it's slightly done in a different way. To achieve composite applications, you may use the service-oriented integration infrastructure as well. But that's not a necessity. Okay? You may call the services directly and still achieve. It will depend on your case, how the services are going to be called and how many consumers are going to be there, right? And lastly, at the enterprise level, we see that people are also moving towards service-oriented architecture in preparation to what we call as the business process management. Just to give you a background about what is different or what is business process management. Here, what people are saying is, now you look at the whole activity which a company does in terms of a process getting executed across departments. Okay? When you say that, what that means is, there's a lot of interaction between systems. First of all, there's a lot of interaction between people of different departments and applications of different departments. So, suppose if you are talking of situation of accepting purchase orders, where for a customer, what you would do is, you would have a website or a portal or a standard application where you would accept your orders. But then that order information as a process within the company, which is within, say, the manufacturing company, actually has to go through many steps. Okay, so somewhere it has to be, you have to check the inventory. If you have, fine. Otherwise, you have to worry about what I'm going to do for this particular order. You have to check whether this customer has enough credit. Otherwise, you have to ask for advance payments if there are, depending on the terms you have. Then, finally, you kind of reach a place where you want to give a order acceptance to the customer. Okay, I will deliver. And then, value additions you may want to do. You may want to give a commitment as to I will deliver on certain date. And of course, you want to mean that and you want to maintain that. So you have a lot of other connections to different other systems which you want to do. So if you, I'm just trying to illustrate a small process, but there are a lot of complexities. Now here, to do each of this work, you have to talk to different systems. Right now, in the example which I gave, so there is a web application, there is an inventory system, there is a available to promise kind of system which will do look at when the production will happen and when we will be able to ship. Okay, there's a shipping system which might also be in the picture. So all this have to be tied together, and then we serve the customer in the front and we are able to give some notification to them. Now what people say is, in business process management, is now because of a lot of competition in the market and we want to be in the business. We want to be very agile. So we want to be able to change the process much faster. It is not that at the click of the button the process is going to change, but then if any changes we want to do, we have to be able to do them really quickly, because the history says that the IT systems become a bottleneck in effecting these changes. Because when you want to change, you have to do changes at the application level. You have to really, we follow this, the whole software development life cycle. We understand the requirements, want to make the changes, then test it out, roll it out, and things like that. That has to be quickened or made faster. So how do you do that? So one of the ways being suggested is you model the processes. So this is the change, or this is how it's going to be different. You have the process in terms of a process model. Okay. That model, you now have tools which will help you to create an executable process model. One of the outputs, or the standard way of the output which is given, is BPEL, which you have kind of done some time ago. So BPEL is the execution part. So it executes in what we call as the orchestration server or the BPEL server. At that point, you are actually going out to different systems and executing the various BPEL entities or activities which are in the BPEL which you have deployed. There, the connectivity is again through services, and that's where SOA comes. Okay, so that's why we say, so when the intention is to go for business process management, we say we see that people first want to establish a foundation, and SOA is a good foundation to have, so that then all the benefits of SOA also are accrued, and then you will have a successful BPM in rollout. Okay, so these are four different ways or reasons why kind of we say that the people adopt SOA. They are not very kind of mutually exclusive, but then if we at any point of time, we want to look at or take a snapshot of the kind of activities which will go on at a customer's place, then it will be much easier to classify, because there is some connotation behind it. When we say business services, it would require simple set of applications which you will service enable. And maybe in terms of infrastructure, you will require application server to host these services if the application doesn't have. If you move on to the service-oriented integration, then it calls for having a ESB kind of a product to be installed. And then a lot of services there, and they are all connected. So there's a different set of things which happen when you have service-oriented integration. When you talk of composite applications, the assumption is you have all these services ready, and now you are going to build these applications using these services. And as I talked of foundation for BPM, you also will be investing in BPM tools and things like that as part of your SOA initiatives. One other thing, I've used the word journey so that I want to give you a picture that never in a customer's place again, that it's a single or a one-shot initiative that you do something and we have implemented SOA. That's not the case. It is actually now probably you will see that there are a lot of things which go into having a large-scale SOA in an enterprise. You would want to build a foundation of services. You will build simple as well as composite applications over it. And then if the need arises, you may have a ESB kind of infrastructure also in place. And that can go on gradually. Okay. So in a sense, it's a SOA journey which a customer actually undertakes. And it is not that somewhere I read that they wanted to explain. So they say SOA is not a product that you just take it in the market and install it. it's not like that. So it's a journey, right? Any questions? Yes. Okay, what are the features which the ESB provides? Number one is the ESB allows you to be accessed using multiple protocols. Okay, standard way if you do or the ways which you have been taught right now, probably you would think that only it is SOAP over HTTP is the way to call services. But then in an enterprise context, you have applications which don't have SOAP support, or you may have a queuing system, message queues, okay? And you want to utilize, because your all your other legacy application is running that way, and then you also want to use this new service. So it is like protocol conversion, if you want to do, if I have to say it in a different way. ESB allows you to do that. Okay, so you can call this same service using multiple or different protocols. That is one of the fundamental features of a ESB. Next is, people said, okay, I want to be able to call not exactly with the syntax which the WSDL of the ESB is providing. I want to do it in a different way. Either there are some limitations or some other reasons. So you could put some intermediate logic in the ESB. That's called mediation, whereby the call which you make from the application is not necessarily exactly in keeping with the WSDL. Okay, so the syntax of your SOAP call, if I have to say, that kind of gets converted. So there's mediation in between which can be achieved. Now, ESB is first a concept. So these are a couple of features which a ESB concept would provide. But now people are actually giving you ESB product. So it is available from various vendors. So definitely they will add something more to be differentiate their product, right? Otherwise, what is the difference for people to choose their product? So then they will have, for an example, I'll give you one example. People say content-based routing if you want. So if you have multiple services and you want to, for an example, very simple example, if it's a multinational company and if it's a simple, messages being exchanged, with a French customer, you want a French reply to come, and with a English customer, you want an English reply. And you may host two different services for that. And then which service you will target will be handled by the ESB. You are not going to say in your application that go hit the English service or go hit the French service. So that kind of routing based on the content, okay? Here the content is, it will somehow detect that it has come from a French national. So these are a couple of the features which the ESB provides. And overall, the main purpose is to be able to achieve integration, to be able to call the services, and on the other side, to be used by certain applications. Any other question?
That means interoperability across applications could be achieved within ESB.
Right. But interoperability is more coming due to the SOAP and such kind of web service standards which you are using, but ESB anyway supports all this kind of.
From legacy application to we are moving toward these standards.
Yeah. Any other question? So that's the background. Yeah, this picture tries to give you just a snapshot as to, or an indicative idea as to kind of investments which would be required when you want to have each type of adoption. So business services is minimal investment. The flexibility which you achieve is also limited. Service-oriented integration, you know, demands a little more. So we talked about the ESB to be implemented. Composite applications still require much higher investment in terms of development costs. You may have a ESB also installed, but the kind of flexibility which it provides is much higher. You know, any changes which you want to make, you just have to make small changes in the composite application. Yes.
So in this case of composite applications,
yes,
that cost will be for the tools who are providing that composition, rather not for the development of the existing components. The existing components are there.
Yes.
They are not required to develop.
Yeah.
The cost is only for the tools.
Right. So now, yeah, if we break it up slightly more, now the two things. So we even assume that the services are there already. Now you will have to build certain applications on top of that. And when you say composite applications, now till now I have you know, not gone too much into details, but you can have multiple types of composition. Okay, in the sense there is static composition, so I have one application and I would call multiple services. But then the extent of complexity can also increase. You may have the BPL kind of engine also incorporated in that and have better or more complex composition done. Okay, there are, you know, examples where you can have all this kind of orchestration behind the scene and you could just expose your applications. They are all examples of still composite applications. Here, the composition is not static but a dynamic composition. So in such cases, you know, the cost is going to increase much more. Okay, and one more thing is, you know, this is just an indicative figure. So you know, if you kind of you know, if we I cannot kind of defend in all cases that composite applications will cost more. But generally, this is what we see, that if you want to have a case of composite applications, there's much more investment. But then, as I said, if you have a plain static composition kind of a requirement, it may be on par or might be lesser than the service-oriented integration also. But that, I would say, is a one-off case.
So yeah. There isn't any room for dynamic composition.
See, today the composition, let us say the concept is kind of setting in. Today there are platforms to enable composition. At least couple of composition environments which I have kind of looked at is, one is from Microsoft. Now today their SharePoint, Microsoft SharePoint server, so today the recent version, they call it MOS, Microsoft Office SharePoint Server 2007, I think that is the name, MOS 2007. Now that today is kind of repackaged or is being talked of in terms of a composition framework. Okay, so they have kind of, if you go to Microsoft site and look at what they call as Office Business Applications. Okay, so there's a site called OBA Central. I won't take time here to dwell on that, but so they have given you different layers where the composition can be, you know, achieved. So they classify five layers. I think they talk from collaboration layer, process layer, services layer, data layer, you know. And each layer, they have given examples or they talk of how composition can be achieved. Second is SAP, the ERP company. So they are also now coming out with you know, integrated set for composition. So I think they call it NetWeaver composition environment. Okay, where with the ERP kind of tools, how do you build a composite application? And in fact, they may not have used the NetWeaver composition environment, but in the SAP world, they have a set of applications called the Duet applications, which are nothing but the composite applications, you know, the implementation of composite applications. Okay, Duet, D-U-E-T. Okay, and again, that may have been the code name or, you know, the earlier name before release. So the release product may not be called Duet, but on the internet, if you search for Duet, I'm sure you will get more details about that. So today these kind of environments are coming, okay, and then there's a whole stack which will allow you to build composite applications. Okay.
As a result, how user will be benefited? Like the companies are getting benefited obviously in terms of reusability of components, interoperability,
yeah,
getting flexible and all.
Yeah.
But how ultimately, end user is getting benefit.
The end user's perspective, the benefit is the convenience that in particular case of composite application, he will be not required to jump onto different applications, number one. Okay, because all what you could do, you can do in say one screen or couple of screens, but they would all be one integrated desktop application for him, or it could be a web application also, it need not be desktop application. So it's a single unified interface, if I have to say, into different applications, number one. Second is, if you look at, and this is actually a situation which happens, if you talk of people who are doing clerical work, say in warehouses or in the shop floors, and manufacturing companies, they have ERPs, so SAP or BAN or that kind of environment. You need to actually train them to use those applications pertaining to their job function. Okay, he may want to check the inventory, so he has to have access to a SAP system. So, and when you want to do check the inventory, there is a particular way in the SAP system where you have to go and press multiple options and then you would land up there. Then you have to train him. Then you may have to train him to get the report of how many items have been produced, or in his shift today, whatever he did in terms of, he will kind of fill in how many items I did, and then he may want to get a report back. These are small functionality, but then it's all in the SAP system. It has to get posted in the transactional system, and hence he's given the SAP user interface, for an example. Now that can be done away probably. You may have a simple application where he just feeds in this number, where we will have to take, application developers will have to take care how you would go and connect to SAP. So we will use SAP services. We may use a ESB and all that behind the scene to push the data into SAP. But that way, we have done away with the SAP interface for the end user. I talked about the example of the project manager who is approving leave. That's a very simple example which I to illustrate. But then similarly, if many of your day-to-day jobs are getting, what say for an example, that thought comes into my mind, portals, why are they becoming much more accepted? Because that's a window to many applications, right? You need not go on to various different sites and things like that, or various applications in your company. You can do sitting with one portal personalized for you. In such way, composite applications also, and in fact, I would put portal also as an example of composite application here, if it is actually being implemented in a service-oriented way. I hope you get the picture. So it's the user convenience. If I had to put it very simply, it's the user convenience which the composite applications bring to the table. Now what I'm going to talk about is a couple of case studies of how we have worked with our customers. Here I'll try to bring about, what are people doing and how it is being done at different customers. So this is a sample of that. So what this picture tries to show in the gray is, this is the how the existing application was structured with one of our customers. On the left side, where you see standard three-tier architecture, presentation, business logic, and the database, nothing great there. But it was being used by 55,000. It's a big company, so 55,000 users were using it. So, and a lot of, and this application pertained to using all the kind of IT services or facilities which they wanted to use. So if they wanted email connection, or if they wanted additional software to be loaded, they all could get communicated. You would subscribe to that service and it would be kind of handled by the IT departments, and they would be billed. Okay, this is a simple, that kind of application which we are talking of. The traditional way the application, when it was developed, was that the billing information used to get transferred to the SAP system, which had the financial information almost as a bad job once in a month. So all your, how much of the service you have consumed, or what expenditure my team had as a department head, if I wanted, I would have to wait for the report which would come out from a SAP system after a month or maybe later on. So we tried to show them, we were actually maintaining this application, but we wanted to show them the benefit of web services, what it could do, so that will kind of act as an impetus for them to look at services, SOA and so on. So we developed a simple set of web services for them, and then tried to, there's a picture of how each one is done, but tried to show that the same information now which the application was capturing, earlier it was not available much easily to be, taken out, now can be done using web services. So here we have a picture where these are all the new things we kind of tried to do it for them, more to show. So we developed the services. Of course, the services are not visible at the user interface level, but then we use the services and build some of these rich GUI kind of applications. This just try to show you, you're getting this information and now are being able to present it in a much more better manner in terms of pie charts and histograms and things like that. Also, you could use the same information, or you could call the services from a mobile platform also. So these are the things which you must have learned that about interoperability using services. So different kinds of applications on a different platform can call them. Okay, and even mobile platform is one of the examples. So one of the things again in adoption now is customers are averse, because when it is a new technology or a new wave, they would want to, they're not very sure whether we should go for it or not. So one of the things which we do is what we call as proof of concept. So POC stands for proof of concept. As you do prototyping, it's a similar thing, but maybe the scale is little larger. Okay. So when you are unsure about things, because it costs also, there is effort to build a POC also. But when you are unsure, POC is a good way to kind of validate what you want to do. So you could build a small case, build a POC, make a simple service, make a simple application, try it out, and then you have the confidence that it all works. You also know what is the kind of infrastructure it will require, whether we have, in terms of development capabilities in-house to do it, or we have to take help from somebody. So proof of concept is also one important mechanism to kind of get on to your SOA journey. This is yet another example where this customer is a very old customer. They have been in business for about 100 years. So and they are into farm equipment. Now, they have a lot of customer information with them, and they have now started new businesses. So they had farm equipment, but then they started to build much more sophisticated equipment for farmers themselves, or they moved into financing and leasing. So when they wanted customer information, it was very hard to get, because this was only in one kind of application which captured. So one of the things which, again here we were maintaining their application, so we said why not use web services. You web service enable your customer registry. That way now the customer information can be extracted out by any other kind of application also. You look at the infrastructure they had earlier, DB2 on mainframe, and then they had earlier COBOL programs running there. So that's indicated in the blue box. Then slowly over years, they kind of have web applications also, wherein they introduce a Java layer, and then JSP and servlets kind of environment they had, wherein they at least could give the customer information over the web. But then still, if you wanted a real-time information about the or the applications actually to have this information, it was still not possible. So web service was one way, wherein in the business layer we kind of did the service enabling, which again you would have learned, we used all the Java APIs to build the services and then expose it as a service. And then they are on their own now to use the services by different applications. So what the message here again is, there are many opportunities also existing in the current applications, which you have to now go back and kind of look at, which you could reuse in newer applications. You could make new applications just by doing little bit of more work on top of your existing applications which you already have. The third flavor of how people have been adopting services, this is a case where we engaged with a software provider company actually, and they were working with a life insurance LIC kind of company. This is a Danish customer whom we were working with, where they said, we want to migrate the whole application, number one. So they again had COBOL based programs on mainframe, where they were having a lot of difficulties maintaining the code, because they don't find programmers there, and then the cost of ownership of a mainframe kind of system is very high. So one is, they wanted to re-engineer and report the application onto a J2E platform. But then they took this opportunity to also have service interfaces there. Okay? And this was a very unique case for us, where there was no user interface for this application. They said, okay, you just give us service interfaces. You build this whole, you migrate this code, port it onto J2E, but then give only service interfaces. Do you realize the fact that testing these service interfaces was a real difficult challenge for us? Okay, we had to build our own frameworks. But again, the message here is, there are some kind of customer who are actually based on total cost of ownership and such considerations, are porting their legacy applications onto newer platforms, and at that point of time, they are looking at also service enabling their applications, and then and that's part of their SOA journey.